The Melancholy Hussar of the German Legion, written by Thomas Hardy, narrated by B.J. Harrison. Chapter 1. Here stretch the downs, high and breezy and green, absolutely unchanged since those eventful days. A plough has never disturbed the turf, and the sod that was uppermost then is uppermost now. Here stood the camp. Here are distinct traces of the banks thrown up for the horses of the cavalry, and spots where the midden heaps lay are still to be observed. At night, when I walk across the lonely place, it is impossible to avoid hearing, amid the scourings of the wind over the grass bents and thistles, the old trumpet and bugle calls, the rattle of the halters, to help seeing rows of spectral tents and the impedimenta of the soldiery. From within the canvases, some guttural syllables of foreign tongues and broken songs of the fatherland, for they were mainly regiments of the King's German Legion that slept round the tent poles hereabout at that time. It was nearly 90 years ago. The British uniform of the period, with its immense epaulets, queer cock hat, breeches, gaiters, ponderous cartridge box, buckled shoes and whatnot, would look strange and barbarous now. Ideas have changed. Invention has followed invention. Soldiers were monumental objects then, a divinity, still hedged kings here and there, and war was considered a glorious thing. Secluded old manor houses and hamlets lie in the ravines and hollows among these hills, where a stranger had hardly ever been seen till the king chose to take the baths yearly at the seaside watering place a few miles to the south, as a consequence of which battalions descended in a cloud upon the open country around. Is it necessary to add that the echoes of many characteristic tales dating from that picturesque time still linger about here in more or less fragmentary form, to be caught by the attentive ear? Some of them I have repeated. Most of them I have forgotten. One I have never repeated, and assuredly can never forget. Phyllis told me the story with her own lips. She was then an old lady of 75, and her auditor a lad of 15. She enjoyed silence as to her share of the incident, till she should be dead, buried, and forgotten. Her life was prolonged 12 years after the day of her narration, and she has now been dead nearly 20. The oblivion, which in her modesty and humility she courted for herself, has only partially fallen on her, with the unfortunate results of inflicting an injustice upon her memory. Since such fragments of her story as got abroad at the time, and have been kept alive ever since, are precisely those which are most unfavorable to her character. It all began with the arrival of the York Hussars, one of the foreign regiments above alluded to. Before that day, scarcely a soul had been seen near her father's house for weeks. When a noise like the brushing skirt of a visitor was heard on the doorstep, it proved to be a scudding leaf. When a carriage seemed to be nearing the door, it was her father, grinding his sickle on the stone in the garden for his favorite relaxation of trimming the box-tree borders to the plots. A sound like luggage thrown down from the coach was a gun far away at sea, and what looked like a tall man by the gate at dusk was a yew-bush cut into a quaint and attenuated shape. There was no such solitude in country places now as there was in those old days. Yet all the while King George and his court were at his favorite seaside resort, not more than 5 miles off. The daughter's seclusion was great. But beyond the seclusion of the girl lay the seclusion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.